Hi everyone, my name is Yazan. I'm a hardware engineer here at Valve. And today, I'd like to talk to you about the Steam Deck hardware and how that might relate to your game. At its heart, Steam Deck is a PC, but it's also a purpose-built machine optimized for handheld gaming. Every single block you see on this diagram has been selected and tuned specifically to provide the best possible experience for playing your games on the go. Today, I'd like to walk you through some of the major blocks on this diagram and explain the roles they play in providing the various experiences we want our customers to enjoy. The first and arguably most important block is the APU. Our APU has four Zen 2 cores capable of 8 threads up to 3.5 gigahertz, and our GPU is RDNA 2 based with 8 CUs running at 1.6 gigahertz. Both of these architectures should be very familiar to you. In fact, we think that most games on Steam will not only be compatible with these architectures, a lot of them will be specifically optimized for it right out of the box. The architecture itself should be familiar, but what's truly novel about our processor is that it was designed from the ground up to be optimized for the 4 to 15-watt power envelope available to us in this form factor. AMD is here with us today, and they'll dive a little bit deeper into the details of this APU, but the one major takeaway that I'd like to leave you with today is that the level of performance per watt we were able to achieve with this processor would simply not have been possible using any off-the-shelf processor that exists today. The other major piece to the performance puzzle is memory. Everyone here probably understands how critical memory is to game performance. And for that reason, we selected LP5. Steam Deck is going to be one of the first devices to utilize LP5. And we went with LP5 for two major reasons. First one is memory bandwidth. Our APU runs at a 128-bit wide memory bus at 5.5 gigahertz. This combines to a total of 88 gigabytes per second worth of bandwidth, which if you compare on a per teraflop basis, actually exceeds a lot of dedicated desktop-grade GPUs. The other advantage to LP5 is power efficiency. LP5 offers a lot of great power-saving features that truly manifest themselves in low-power scenarios like 2D games, idle, and sleep. You might have also noticed that we have 16 gigabyte. This is unified between the CPU and the GPU. And the reason why we went with 16 gigabyte is that although most games on Steam today are more than happy with 8 or even 12 gigabyte, we think that that might change in the future. And we really wanted to make sure that Steam Deck is not only compatible with games that exist today, it could also run games that haven't even come out yet. Having a performant APU and memory is not enough. We also need to make sure that the power and thermal policy for this product makes sense. Our primary objective was to provide consistent performance for extended periods of time. Unlike a lot of laptops and phones, we do not rely on things like turbo boost, peak clocks, or any kind of bursty performance, and instead use only clocks that we think we can sustain indefinitely. What that translates to is that the performance your game gets in the first 10 seconds is likely to be the same performance you get 2 hours from now, or maybe even indefinitely if you're plugged into the wall. And that's not the only thing we focused on. We also wanted to provide consistent performance across a wide range of scenarios. You should get the same performance whether you are plugged in, on battery, docked, charging, not charging, downloading games, or even in some elevated ambient temperatures. With that said, there's definitely a limit. If you're in Florida in July, you might run out of thermal headroom. And when that happens, we'll do our best to maintain the GPU performance by throttling things like charge rates, download speeds, even SSD bandwidth, to try to maintain the GPU clock running as high as possible for as long as possible. We can't talk about performance without also talking about battery life. And we spent a lot of effort making sure that every single subsystem in Steam Deck is running at its most efficient point. But really, all of that should be very transparent to you. The one thing that you should note is that we did not place any artificial limits on how much power the APU can consume. For that reason, we think that most games would benefit from having some kind of an FPS limit, whether that be 60 FPS to match the display, or 30 FPS for some of the more GPU-bound games. If your game already has an FPS limiter, then that's great. If not, we're working on a global FPS limiter that will allow the user to pick the optimal balance between performance and battery life that suits their needs. Another aspect to battery life that we really focused on is power consumption during sleep. We think that a lot of our customers are really going to enjoy being able to suspend their device, walk away for hours, maybe even days, and come back and jump right where they left off in their game. We really encourage you to take advantage of that by making sure that your game is robust to being suspended for long periods of time. Now, despite our best efforts, Steam Deck does have to be charged every once in a while. And for that reason, we have a Type-C port capable of 45 watts. That should be enough power to both run the device at max load and simultaneously charge it at full rate. The Type-C port could also support external peripherals up to 7.5 watts, which is enough for things like webcams, wired controllers, or even storage devices. You could also use the Type-C port for docking, and in that mode, we can support up to 2 4K displays at 60 Hz. And if you opt for half the display bandwidth, you will get USB 3 Gen 2 instead. At this point in time, I'd like to shift gears a little bit away from power and performance to talk about other subsystems like audio. For audio, Steam Deck users will have many options. They can either use the built-in speakers, headphone jack, built-in microphones, Bluetooth audio, or even audio over HDMI or DisplayPort if they're docked. Every single one of those options has a slightly different audio processing pipeline. For the built-in speakers, we have a dedicated amp and DSP that monitors the speakers in real time and adjusts the audio stream accordingly. Every single Steam Deck has been calibrated at the factory to provide the best possible performance, and we're really proud of the level of fidelity we were able to achieve with this setup. On the other hand, the headphone jack and the built-in microphones, although do have a dedicated codec, we opted to do more software-based processing than hardware. We rely on Steam itself to do some of the most advanced techniques like echo cancellation, and we think this approach provides better flexibility and more compatibility with various different pieces of software and hardware. I also mentioned Bluetooth audio. Steam Deck supports Bluetooth 5.0. And the great thing about Bluetooth 5.0 is that it can support Bluetooth low energy and Bluetooth enhanced data rate devices simultaneously. It also has double the bandwidth of Bluetooth 4. What that means is that you should be able to use your Bluetooth headphones and several Bluetooth controllers at the same time. In addition to Bluetooth, Steam Deck also supports Wi-Fi AC, which provides up to 866 megabits per second worth of bandwidth. At that level, we think that Wi-Fi bandwidth is unlikely to be the bottleneck for your game downloads. Wi-Fi bandwidth is only half the story. We also focused on Wi-Fi reliability and Wi-Fi robustness, even in congested RF environments. We wanted to provide a first-class Steam Remote Play experience on Steam Deck, and we think that for our customers who have a powerful PC and good Wi-Fi at home, they are really going to enjoy being able to play their games at a substantially reduced power consumption compared to running the game natively on the device. Finally, the last block I'm talking about today is storage. Just like with audio, Steam Deck customers will have several options. They can even run their games on the built-in SSD or opt for removable libraries using an SD card reader or USB 3-based storage devices. If you compare these options on paper, they have very different levels of performance when it comes to read and write speeds. But if, as you can see on this chart, if you actually compare them in terms of user experience, you'll find that that difference shrinks quite a bit. When it comes to load times, the SD card reader loads the game about 18% slower compared to the NVMe 512 gigabyte SSD. Similarly, when it comes to boot times, the 64 gigabyte eMMC boots 25% slower compared to the built-in NVMe SSD. Now, I do want to emphasize that this represents a single data point and that different games might scale differently. But in general, we think this data is quite representative of most games. Now, the difference between the different storage options is definitely meaningful and is consistent. However, we think at this level of performance, all three of them offer a great experience and our customers will be very happy with regardless of which option they choose. This covers the major blocks in the Steam Deck hardware. I hope you found this information helpful, and I look forward to taking your questions in the Q&A session. Thank you.